the facts, they're not important. The story was pre-written. So just to give you one example, I did not sit next to General Flynn. We have photographs. We tell the journalists, so-called journalists, we have the photographs. They refuse to accept it. They still print. Like, it's a small point, but it's a very significant one. Why would they print that I sat next to him when I didn't? If they didn't have an agenda, if the story wasn't pre-written, why don't you say actually she sat on the opposite side of him, right, of the table? The story was pre-written, the narrative was preset. The truth did not matter.
In her own words, how is Svetlana Lokhova, an intelligence historian and fellow at the University of Cambridge, suddenly swept up into the Spygate scandal? What was the real nature of her relationship with General Michael Flynn, who recently had all charges against him dismissed by the Department of Justice? And what has been the personal cost of being targeted for her, her family, and her career? In this episode, we'll sit down with Svetlana Lokhova, a former fellow of the Cambridge Security Initiative, jointly chaired by the former head of MI6, Sir Richard Dearlove. She describes herself as an eyewitness to the Spygate scandal. She is also author of The Spy Who Changed History, the untold story of how the Soviet Union stole America's top secrets. This is American Thought Leaders, and I'm Jekielek. Svetlana Lokhova, very good to have you on American Thought Leaders.
Nice to meet you.
So Svetlana, you play a significant role in a, I guess, difficult chapter of American history. You've been accused of being a Russian spy connected with General Flynn. At the same time, we know that you're a scholar of intelligence. You've written the book, The Spy Who Changed History. Your book is on the reading lists in Cambridge University and the CIA. And probably there's people out there wondering, is she a scholar? Is she a spy? There's a lot of questions in people's minds. Let's start with your story. How did this all begin?
It all began at Cambridge University. So I was a postgraduate researcher, and I was teaching as well at the University of Cambridge, and I was writing a book with my mentor of 20 years. We were writing this book, which is now known as The Spy Who Changed History, and this is about 1930s. The book is about 1930s, and that's the area of my research, so a very long time ago.
And that's Christopher Andrew.
That's Christopher Andrew.
Okay, that's
and
right.
So I'm at Cambridge University teaching, studying, and writing, and that's my life. And this being Cambridge, we get a lot of very important visitors coming to Cambridge monthly. And in this particular case, we had somebody who I never heard of before, but of course somebody who was very important in America. In 2014, General Flynn, he was the head of Obama's military intelligence, DIA. And he was visiting Cambridge University, giving presentation to our students. And afterwards, there was a dinner in his honor. And I was one of the selected few who the senior people within our Cambridge group invited to participate in this very important dinner, because we were meant to impress the DIA with the quality of our Cambridge research.
So you ended up at this dinner. It wasn't a nefarious plan on your part to contact Flynn.
Absolutely not. So I was invited to the dinner by Christopher Andrew, who was my, again, professor of 20 years, and by Sir Richard Dearlove, who used to be the head of MI6, so that's British Foreign Intelligence Service, and he then later became a master of a Cambridge college, Pembroke. So 1 month before Flynn's visit, we were invited, and our names got taken down, everyone who would attend. Those names got sent to DIA for approval in advance, because of course you wouldn't allow your head of military intelligence to walk into a room with random strangers, right? Like, everyone had to be pre-vetted.
Yes.
And obviously the British security services would do their own vetting on their side. And the dinner took place in home, in a lodge, a private lodge, of Sir Mr. Richard Dearlove, former head of MI6. So it was his private dinner in honor of General Flynn, and everyone who was invited there were handpicked and vetted. That's why it's ridiculous to suggest that first of all, I didn't even know who Flynn was, but secondly, I was invited to that dinner and pre-vetted.
You know, the dinner happened. It was a reasonable occasion. Nothing in particularly of note, I guess. That's what you've told me offline. But then later, things started to happen. What happened?
So the dinner was just another occasion. It was notable because General Flynn is a very important guest. It was a huge honor. We had some interesting conversations. So at the end of the dinner, I showed him some of my research on Stalin, Joseph Stalin. He was very interested in that. It was part of the group conversation about my research. We left the dinner and that was it. And that's in February 2014. Okay. And then since then, other dinners happened. We had actually General Flynn's successor, General Stuart, coming to Cambridge. So I was invited to meet him a year later. There were other dignitaries coming, and I continued being invited to this event. I continued teaching, I continued writing, so my normal life. And then I was pregnant with my first child in December 2016. And I get a call from Times of London, from chief reporter, and they're asking me if I'm a Russian spy.
For the record, do you or anyone close to you have any connection to Russian intelligence?
Absolutely not.
Yeah.
I see you smiling because it's such an outrageous suggestion to make about the person.
What was being said? First of all, who was asking these questions and what was being asked?
So we had this very strange, which what we know today, of course, changes the perspective of what happened. But we had this very strange event in Cambridge in November, December 2016.
Okay.
Which was that I wasn't actually at Cambridge because I was about to give birth. So I was in London expecting, sorting out hospital and things like that. But I, on one Saturday, I opened front page of a London financial newspaper, Financial Times, and so Richard Dearlove, so that's the former head of MI6,
yes,
Master of Pembroke, on the front page, and then I saw the picture of my own professor, next to also the picture of one Stefan Halper, another Cambridge professor, and the article said that Stefan Halper and Richard Dearlove resigned from Cambridge seminar, of which I'm a member, because Russians penetrated it, the Kremlin penetrated it, and it was some kind of really bizarre story. So I immediately called up my professor and said, what's all of this about? And he said to me, it's a bunch of nonsense, and that there's some kind of academic dispute between him and Halper and others about, I think it's to do with teaching and money, some kind of academic thing.
Okay.
And they were somehow spilled into the newspapers, and then he's going to write to Halper to get this withdrawn because it's not true. And it's all going to be sorted out. So that's how it was explained to me. And the next day, I then also get a call from Times chief reporter, and he says to me that I'm this Russian spy who penetrated this Cambridge University. I have no idea what they're talking about, frankly. I'm just shocked, but mainly just don't know what even to say. So what I do is I call my lawyer, and my lawyer tells the Times that if they publish, we're going to sue. And UK libel laws are pretty tough, so nothing gets published about me. So the article about Cambridge Intelligence Seminar being penetrated by this Russian spy, that comes out, but the article about me being a Russian spy doesn't. So from that perspective, that's gone. But then the next thing that happens, this is I now have given birth, so my baby's 3 weeks old.
Okay.
I get this very strange email from Wall Street Journal in US asking me about my relationship with General Flynn. And remember, this is the man I met once 3 years previously. Never had a relationship, never met him ever since. So I don't know what's that about. So I then receive a panicked call from another person at Cambridge University called Professor Kent. And he said that he's been approached by Wall Street Journal, who told them that I had an affair with General Flynn, that I approached him before that Cambridge dinner in 2014. I sat next to him, I left the room with him, and we had an affair. which was absolutely shocking. So again, we go to lawyers and we issue a statement. My husband issues a statement on my behalf that I never met General Flynn apart from one time. I didn't have an affair with him. I never approached him, never sat next to him. Actually, my husband picked me up from the dinner. So it's all complete lies. And that their source is acting maliciously.
I see. So this was, it was a completely different context that you were imagining.
That's
at the
right.
Time.
That's right. So I thought something was a fight between some powerful guys at Cambridge, somehow spilled out into the newspapers. But then the next thing that happens is within 24 hours of this approach from Wall Street Journal with accusations that I'm a Russian spy, I also get approached by David Ignatius of Washington Post. Now, I didn't know then who David Ignatius was, but now, of course, I know that he's somebody very, very well known, somebody who is feared, and there's some association with him, between him and security services, the CIA, and that actually within a few weeks previously, he published that leaked phone call that caused General Flynn his job. I didn't know any of that. All I knew is I had this one approach, and very quickly, these guys, like the old American publications, they all know my name, they know my email address, and they all at the same time come to me with this allegation about having an affair with a man I met once 3 years previously. Like, how do they know this, right? Like, who told them this? And I don't understand where all these people are coming from and what's happening. So David Ignatius flew from Washington to England and attempted to meet me. He sends me an email, and my own professor sends me an additional email, we have those emails, which encourages him to meet David Ignatius, and he said that he's a close friend of Christopher Andrew, and that he has an inside track on Flynn's career. I didn't understand that at the time, but the guy just caused General Flynn to resign. And Ignatius is asking me to meet up with him. And both emails suggest that if I were to meet up with David Ignatius and discuss General Flynn, then he would help me with my book, which I'm finalizing right now.
Fascinating.
So yeah, and I refused because it was a very, very suspicious circumstance. So I sent him the same statement that we sent to Wall Street Journal. And then I get another approach from New York Times, Matthew Rosenberg, who works closely with right. Adam Goldman. Again, relationship with General Flynn. Again, I send them, by this stage, I'm really freaking out because it's all happening very quickly. So this is now the fourth approach. And I again send them that standard statement. Then within, so this is 28th of February to 1st of March, they all come to me within 48 hours, all these people suddenly.
Fascinating.
And I also now know that Luke Harding of Guardian, so Guardian is a UK newspaper, and he gets in touch with my professor, again, with the same thing about relationship between me and Christopher, between me and General Flynn. So I don't know where any of this coming from. And then to just make the whole story even worse, I find out that this is end of February, but I find out that 2 weeks previously, my own professor, the man who's known me for 20 years, published an article without naming me, but describing me enough so that people know who I am, in Sunday Times. And the article is about General Flynn, and it's a misleading representation of the DNR of 2014. And in that article, he said that General Flynn was attracted to me, was struck by me. He also said that General Flynn, that I showed him an erotic card. I showed him my research, and there was nothing erotic about my research. And that he invited me to go to Moscow with him. Again, complete lie. And this is my own professor, without telling me anything about this, he went and published this article. But now, of course, we know that all of this was coordinated. And when I asked him to withdraw that article on the basis that it's a lie, he said he was under pressure to put that in.
It must have felt like a major betrayal.
Well, I frankly didn't know what was going on. So you sit in your room with your baby, 3 weeks old, you're a first time mom, you're very, very unwell from childbirth. You don't know how to cope with a new baby. You also have a book deadline, so you're trying to finish that. And then all these Americans and these people, they all descend on you, and you don't know what's going on. You're just in this. So I was in some kind of like haze. So my husband was trying to deal with all of that. Whereas I was just in some kind of parallel universe where for somebody, you know, I've been in Britain for 20 years, I'm a UK citizen, I'm a well-respected academic. So how I ended up in the center of this, what started to look like a really bad scandal, I had no idea. And then Wall Street Journal, 2 weeks later, go ahead and publish that article that they threatened they were going to publish. They didn't precisely put the affair thing because I threatened to sue them, but they put other misleading information such as that I approached General Flynn and that I sat next to him. None of that is true. That General Flynn failed to report meeting with me. It's not true because it was already pre-reported. That this contact between me and General Flynn forms a pattern of his, you know, behavior of meeting Russians and hiding that. Again, not true. And that came to contact of US intelligence. And the article was printed by somebody, Carol Lee, who was a chief White House correspondent. It was also printed by someone, the second person is Shane Harris. So these were people at the top of that whole, you know, Spygate sort of media taking this hit on me. And my husband, but we didn't know that at the time, right? We just knew that this said this fake article's coming out. So my husband called the newspapers up. I couldn't. I was pretty much in tears, and I was just I just didn't know what to say, what to do. So you're supposed to be dealing with congratulations on your newborn, instead of which you're on the phone with reporters in America in the middle of the night because of the time zone difference. So I remember, you know, just like holding the baby, walking up and down the room while she was screaming, and my husband swearing he never swore before at this reporter saying, don't put her name in the paper, why are you doing this to us, right? And the Wall Street Journal guy says to him, it's not about her, it's about General Flynn.
Interesting, wow. You know, it's very difficult to even know what to say. I've been speechless a few times today, but this is something else. There's been a bit written about you, and I want to give an opportunity to for you to kind of speak to some of these things. One of the places that you worked during your career, you took a bit of a sojourn and you worked in finance, and you worked for Troika Dialogue, right, the bank. And this company obviously is, you know, has strong ties to Russia and so forth, and this is being used as evidence that you have ties to Russian intelligence somehow. What do you say to that?
So after I graduated from university, as all my peers, I took a job in banking because being a historian, unfortunately, is very interesting, but doesn't pay the bills.
Yeah.
So I worked for Citigroup, I worked for Morgan Stanley, I worked for Troika Dialogue, which is a UK company, but with a head office in Russia. But I worked, so my company was a UK company, so I was another regular UK employee. And that company later, after I left, got overtaken by Sberbank,
yes,
who is a Russian state company, that's Russian state bank, but I didn't work for that company, that was before my time. After my time. And what it's very clever what they did, because what you know, those who set up what we now know is this operation, because by tying me, they deliberately say that I work for Sberbank. I never did. And the reason why they need to say that is they want to link me to the Russian state and therefore show that I'm a Russian spy. Not that it makes any sense, but that's the way they do things.
But working for a state bank, does everyone working for Sberbank, are they a Russian spy?
Exactly. I mean, of course not. But this is the thing. It's exactly what happened with that dinner, right? The facts, they're not important. The story was pre-written. So just to give you one example, I did not sit next to General Flynn. We have photographs. We tell the journalists, so-called journalists, we have the photographs. They refuse to accept it. They still print. Like, it's a small point, but it's a very significant one. Why would they print that I sat next to him when I didn't? If they didn't have an agenda, if the story wasn't pre-written, why don't you say actually she sat on the opposite side of him, right, of the table? And the same with this working for Sberbank. I didn't work for Sberbank. I worked for another company, right, which wasn't a state bank. Not that it matters, because as you say, you know, not everyone who works for a bank, state bank, is necessarily a spy. Probably not actually. But it's even little details. They have to. The story was pre-written, the narrative was preset. The truth did not matter. And then the next thing, sorry, that happens is after that Wall Street Journal article comes out, it's followed by Luke Harding article, where they say that there was this new evidence that spy chiefs had concern over General Flynn, and that I'm one of the reasons that spy chiefs had concerns about General Flynn. And they specifically say that those concerns were voiced at the time that General Flynn was being appointed as National Security Advisor by Trump. So do you remember, if we go back quickly in time, that do you remember when I was being approached, there was this Halper article about Cambridge being penetrated by spies, followed by allegations against me that I'm a Russian spy. The timing of that is because they were trying to stop General Flynn from being appointed as National Security Advisor, right?
I see.
And so they used that fake story in order to try stop him being hired, but Trump ignored him and appointed him. So then they started trying to figure out how to get rid of him. But the net result to me is my face, my photograph was plastered in all the UK newspapers. And then we had people going door to door, we had journalists going to door with my photographs, knocking on people's doors, my neighbors and mine, showing the photograph saying, where is this spy? So the, and in this fevered atmosphere of this Russian espionage, I started receiving death threats, credible death threats. So we had to have police involved. And you know, police don't just sort of arrive at your home with weapons and stuff just for nothing, right? Like, it got really serious because they considered the threats sent a physical address and they took them really seriously. And the thing is, I was never interviewed by any security services either in UK or US, so that clearly wasn't an issue at all. They didn't believe it, but they put it into the public domain, which meant that we had to move, we had to flee.
Let me get this straight, okay? So these journalists are coming to you, people going around with your photo asking, you know, about you as a spy, but you're saying that the intelligence services aren't interviewing you?
Not a single one of them. No MI5, MI6, CIA, you name it. Nobody asked me a single question because they know I'm not. I've been in England, I lived in England for 20 years. I'm a UK citizen. I'm actually well known to them because we had not just General Flynn coming to Cambridge University, we had both UK and US senior intelligence officials and other officials coming to Cambridge. They all met me. Everyone knows the one thing I'm not is a spy. That's why it's so ridiculous, because it was all played out in the press. But the real result of this, it wasn't just words. We had to move because I had a young baby and it was getting very, very aggressive.
What about your job at Cambridge?
Well, that also disappeared because, unfortunately, because of the newspaper coverage.
So, Svetlana, you only met General Flynn on one occasion, but then you had some email communications with him, right? And now, was it just you having those communications, or was, for example, Christopher Andrew always sort of CC'd on them? Because I know he was a part of it. And can you kind of speak to that communication
of
a little
course,
bit?
Yeah. Sure. So, I previously mentioned, I was asked by Christopher Andrew and Richard Dearlove to show General Flynn the research project I was working on, which is Joseph Stalin.
Yes.
And I showed a card with Stalin's handwriting
yes.
on it. And General
Flynn... This was what was later said was the erotic
That's
thing, right.
That's
okay,
right,
but
yes.
Please continue.
General Flynn was very interested in this research, and he asked me to send a copy of the document to him via email, because I had it on my iPad, I had a scanned copy. And I said, sure, of course. And I was also encouraged because by that stage then I have his email address. Remember at that point DIA was a very important client of Cambridge University, so there was a joint venture
okay.
where DIA and Cambridge, they were sort of using Cambridge University and our research as a sort of outpost for their intelligence, so to speak. And so that's why we had such a you know, great dinner in honor of General Flynn, is in order to impress him, right? Because they wanted to continue this relationship. And one of the things that was happening is we were organizing a joint conference between DIA and Cambridge, which actually happened the following year and at which I was one of the speakers. And so from that perspective, I was encouraged by my superiors, so Christopher Andrew and Richard Dearlove, to continue this email communication with him on work-related issues. And Christopher Andrew and Dearlove were either copied on that, or I'd forward the emails afterwards. So it was to send that document that we just described. Then it was just to email about the conference, the details of the conference. There was one email where Christopher Andrew wasn't copied, and which is very interesting, is in July 2016, I lost my book contract and I didn't know why. And we'll come to that because when we talk more about Halper, right? And Christopher Andrew also stopped communicating with me. So we were used to write the book together, and then he stopped because he was upset with me. We'll come to that in a minute, that I refused to attend his dinner with Stefan Halper. And so we were no longer writing a book together. So I was on my own trying to find a publisher for US book. So I had a publisher, but now I lost them because of the situation with Halper and Andrew. And so I was looking for a new publisher. And I didn't know many people in America, pretty much nobody who could verify that my research is good. So I approached two people, and one of them was General Flynn in America, to say, oh, would you be able to give me a recommendation, you know, to the publisher that you've seen my research and it's of good quality? And he said, yeah, sure.
Let's talk about Stefan Halper. When did you meet Halper?
So I met Halper at Cambridge University, I think in 2012, I don't remember precisely, but he was always around. So we had something called Cambridge Intelligence Seminar, yes, which was a forum for those who, students of intelligence working on the subject. They would meet every week, something really boring, where like Friday night, 5 o'clock, maybe 10 of us would meet every week. And the idea was to exchange research.
And Christopher Andrew is the one who pulled you into
That's right. So he was the founder, and I've been a member since I was a kid, like when I was an undergraduate. You go there first to listen how people talk about their research material, and then later you start speaking. It's, you know, they give you 5 minutes and then more, and then you end up with an hour, which is just amazing. So it's something for scholars of intelligence to exchange ideas. In my case, for example, it's 1930, so I worked on archival material,
yes,
from the Soviet archives.
Yes.
So I would bring typically, you know, an example of a document, or sometimes I'll give a full presentation to that seminar, you know, along with other people. And so Christopher Andrew was the founder of that seminar, and he had a co-convener, and two co-conveners rather, called Stefan Halper and Richard Dearlove. And that meant that pretty much every week Halper and I would be in the same room. In January 2016, I get an invitation from my professor, and he wants me to come to dinner with Stefan Halper. So remember, the same Stefan Halper that was in the same room with me every week for 5 years,
yes,
no interest in me. He wants to have dinner with me at the private home at my professor's home and look at my research. The research he absolutely ignored up until that point. And I refused, just because he was such a horrible, obnoxious, rude man. I refused that dinner. And my professor got really, really upset about that. So he started shouting at me, which he never, I've known this guy for 20 years, and I rejected, you know, sometimes other dinners just because I didn't have time. And he never minded that, right? And then suddenly over something which seemingly was unimportant, he'd gone absolutely bonkers, and he was shouting, and he was saying that how could I? So he clearly, now I know, was under a lot of pressure. And then the next thing that happens is, this is January 2016, the next thing that happens is my professor breaks the contract. So we have this very big contract to publish,
right,
this
book
together, mm-hmm, which now known as The Spy Who Changed History. So we were meant to co-author it, and we were quite good way. We had an amazing contract from US and UK publishers. He doesn't want to do it anymore. He can't explain why. He was going on about his health and other things, but it was a lot of money, right? So, and also, you know, a lot of good research. So I couldn't understand why he would suddenly do it. That immediately followed that dinner. Then the next thing that happens is I get told that there's this rumor circulating about me by Halper around university, kind of whisper campaign, and my teaching dries up. So I lose the contract, teaching dries up, and I don't know what's going on. So I just think, okay, he's just this horrible man, but that's it. But then in December that same year, we then have this newspaper article, which he,
yes,
says that Russians penetrated Cambridge, and there he, Cambridge University, and there he's under his own name. So that's when you know it's getting really, really serious, right? Because he put his name on it, his photograph is there. And it got so bad that they were even thinking about starting an inquiry in UK Parliament, in the UK version of your, you know, you have the Intelligence Committee in the Senate.
Yes.
We have the same one in UK. And people were talking about starting an inquiry into me, the Russian spy, as a result of Halper's article. So it got really, really bad.
So just briefly, you seem to still have, you know, hold Christopher Andrew in a little bit of esteem, despite all this.
Well, you know, I moved to, well, it was Soviet Union and it collapsed, so from Russia, which was a very bad time for Russia, 1998. I immigrated from Russia to UK. And I got a place at Cambridge University. You can understand that it's like getting, you know, imagine you're from third world country and you get into Harvard like that and you're 18. And the first person I meet there is Christopher Andrew. So for me, this was like, he was like God, right? And he mentored me. So I actually wasn't interested in history of intelligence at all. I was doing modern European history. So he was actually teaching me things like us, you know, things like Second World War, etc. And then he said, oh, Russian archives just been open following the collapse of Soviet Union. So why don't you do this course with me on the history of intelligence, specializing in Russia, because you're a Russian speaker. So he was actually the one who brought me into the field of intelligence studies, because he doesn't speak Russian and he's one of the foremost experts in intelligence. And he needed somebody like a research assistant to help him to translate the documents.
Okay.
So that's how I got brought into the field. And then he helped me to, you know, with my studies, with my master's, and I was writing a PhD under him. And also we were close friends as families. So we would meet regularly with him and his family. So for me, I still am processing how somebody who I've known for 20 years, but also since I was a kid, how could he possibly have done this? I don't know.
So, Svetlana, it seems like your academic career is kind of, as a result of all of this, is a bit in tatters, right? I can see you've become a bit of a Twitter activist of sorts. I don't know if that's the right thing to call it, but you're certainly seeing things, pointing them out, calling things out. Where do you see your life going from here?
Well, so remember when all of these bad things happened to me. My life was ruined. Nobody in Cambridge wanted to have anything to do with me. My publisher, you know, didn't want to deal with me. Nobody wanted to deal with this Russian spy in the newspapers. And I also lost friends because, again, people didn't want to be associated with somebody who is part of this massive scandal with Trump and Flynn and all of that. And so I lost pretty much most of, you know, lost my career, lost my friends. Now, I was trying to get press to tell my story, the members of the press, and they refused. Nobody wanted to cover it. And so that's why I joined Twitter. So I joined Twitter, you can even look it up, in May 2017 specifically because I have no other way of telling my story because it was being suppressed because the media, remember, were part and willing enablers. So I joined Twitter and initially I have 1 follower, 2 followers, 5 followers, 10 followers, and then now the number is 27,000 and growing, which is not bad for somebody who's a foreigner and who didn't have, you know, I'm not a celebrity, I'm not a politician, right? But what happened is I found other people on social media and, you know, there was this very famous speech that General Flynn gave about digital army, how the world is changing, how there's an army of digital soldiers who are on social media. Because unfortunately, the regular media is no longer trusted. And of course, this is where, you know, Epoch Time also plays such an important role. So, for example, I was reading a lot of the great information you put out as part of my own research. And so we're now all in this together, where we all have to demand and use our voices to bring these people, hold them accountable for what they've done to your country, to my family, to other families, and to our way of life. So that's what my plan now is to bring accountability. I mean, in the meantime, I'm still continuing to write. So I'm writing my next book on historical events. But at the same time, I until these people are held accountable, I feel that both me and others around me must continue and demand accountability.
Svetlana Lokhova, such a pleasure to speak with you.
Very good to speak to you. Thank you.
After we interviewed Svetlana Lokhova, we reached out to the individuals and organizations that she discussed in the interview. when we couldn't get independent corroboration of her claims. We excluded some portions where those mentioned disputed what she said. Stefan Halper's lawyers told us, quote, "Your list of questions to Professor Halper are false and defamatory," end quote. Sean O'Neill and Christopher Andrew did not reply to our questions. The Washington Post offered no comment, and the Wall Street Journal said, "We stand by our reporting."